Okay, well, thank you for coming out today on this lovely afternoon. I'm going to be discussing the role of piano in Irish traditional music and lecture, and then you're going to be treated to a wonderful performance by the Irish traditional music ensemble, who's seated over at that table. In terms of format, we're going to bring up different members at different times to highlight different parts of the lecture. So you'll see full players, sometimes the full ensemble. Hopefully you'll enjoy that. This research really stems from my own personal interest in terms of playing piano and playing Irish music on the piano, and led to some of my scholarly investigation about the role of the piano in Irish traditional music. So I'll start there, and then we'll start. The role of the piano in Irish traditional music is a contested one. Since its inclusion in certain Irish traditional music contexts in the early decades of the 1900s, the piano has gradually been incorporated into different musical practices, particularly in Irish music, and has slowly garnered a level of acceptance amongst musicians and enthusiasts alike. The piano's ability to provide both harmonic and rhythmic accompaniment, as well as perform melodically, has raised issues regarding authenticity and the musically appropriate role for the piano in Irish traditional music. Historically, this role has been defined and redefined by celebrated practitioners such as Kitty Linnane all the way to the Hall of Schools, who have sought to expand and develop the use of the piano. This evolutionary process has resulted in the development of new pianistic techniques and conceptual approaches designed to meet the challenging demands of Irish traditional music performance. Using ethnographic and historical research methodologies, this paper analyzes the historical evolution of the role of the piano in Irish traditional music. My research focuses upon pianists from both Irish diasporic musical communities in North America, particularly in the United States of America, and then, of course, in Ireland. Many of the interviews yielded information pertaining to pianistic musical practices, musical contexts, relations to Irish traditional music, musical history, new pianistic instrumental techniques, and the evolving role of the piano, of course, in Irish tradition. This research examines the unique historical narrative that has been constructed concerning the role of the piano in Irish traditional music, and seeks to illuminate how this narrative continues to inform pianistic Now, as many of you know, and I know most of you are musicians here, the pianoforte, which is a lovely example here before you, was invented by Bartolomeo Cristofori in Padua, Italy, in the 18th century. It was seen as a major improvement upon the harpsichord, in particular because of the difference being a cloth hammer hitting the majority of which are three strings instead of one, and also instead of plucking motion that we find with the harpsichord. You also have the ability to sustain notes. You have the 7.5 octaves, and of course, it can sort of continue to play multiple musical lines as well as providing a wider range of dynamics, hence the name pianoforte. And so, in terms of its role musically, you can hear that it's wonderful in terms of providing rhythmic and harmonic accompaniment, but it also can provide work as a leading melody player. And so, we're going to see this coming back. It should be noted, however, that although it has these different musical applications, that it is limited by its large mobile design, by its expense, and of course by its complex tuning system. It's not like a guitar where you just reach in there and crank it up. It takes a good bit of time, which most of you should have. But that being said, while the piano has been incorporated into many different musical traditions, it wasn't until the 20th century that we see a consistent role for piano in Irish traditional music. Prior to this, individual musicians had attempted in various forms to perform strains of Irish music on the piano. Now, for the purposes of this paper, we'll define Irish traditional music as being the older dance music and song in Ireland that is distinct from 19th century national, parlor, and popular music. The first widely documented case concerning this practice can be attributed to the Anglo-Irish musicologist Edward Blunty, who we'll see here. Make that out. He's looking rather grim in that painting. And his work, or most famous work, I should say, begins in 1792 at the Belfast Harp Festival, where he begins to transcribe and collect the music of Irish harpers, particularly by Turlough O'Carolan and Rory Dell Cathay, which resulted in his 1796 publication, The Ancient Music of Ireland, and also subsequent publications in 1809 and 1840. For this paper, we're going to be in particular looking at the 1840 edition. The airs, in this case, really, airs is referring to just the melodies. The airs concerts found in this publication were arranged for piano. As a classically trained pianist and organist, Western art music tradition greatly informed Bunting's harmonization of these airs. In particular, Bunting largely ignored the modal character of these airs and chose to publish certain airs and keys that would have been impossible for harpists to perform. However, Bunting's editing decisions may not have been entirely musically driven. As a musicologist and author, Bunting's manuscript caters to a musically literate audience that would have expected notated arrangements of Irish airs couched in the Western art music aesthetic. Through the sheer fact that Bunting notates music from an oral tradition, he's signifying that his manuscript is not intended for musically illiterate Irish musicians, but instead for musically literate amateur musicians, scholars, intellectuals, and collectors. Now, in this musical example you can see here, this is taken from the 1840 publication of Bunting's. We can see in the Princess Royale that he's taken a tune that he got from the Belfast Harp Festival there, and he's put it into F minor. From my head over here, but you can see that it is from the key signature, and of course it ends there in F. That's quite important because if we think about the Irish harp from which he took this, its tuning is in D mixolydian. And we can see I lifted this as well from the preface to The Ancient Music of Ireland by Bunting, and he clearly outlines the way in which the harp is tuned, and so therefore he would not be able to play in F minor. He's done this again, and actually does this throughout his publication, of looking at different songs that he's collected from these harpists and then transposing them into keys that they would not be able to perform. In this example, we see that it's in B flat major. Once again, this would have been played in D. This particular tune is entitled The Bonnie Cuckoo. Now, this was a favorite of the harpist Turlico Carolyn. And so later on, Turlico Carolyn, and he would have been performing this in D major, not in D flat major, renamed it She Begs She More, which is a favorite tune of his. And he added the lyrics as well to that and changed it from Bonnie Cuckoo to She Begs She More. She Begs She More is roughly in Irish, is varying translations, but it's basically large fairy hill. And so you can see this sort of interesting, the melody was preserved in the same way in which Turlico Carolyn would have played as transposed, and then this sort of arpeggiation that you see here. So, for the purposes of this lecture recital, we're going to perform She Begs You More. At this point, I'm going to bring up Josie Davenport, who's going to be playing flute on this lovely tune. I would like to point out just before I quite glad she's here as well. But it's important to point out for this tune that Turlico Carolyn would have played a wide variety of music, some of which was Irish dance music. In this case, this is more of a closer to a slower air. The way we think about that, meaning that there's a greater individual preference for ornamentation, for interpretation, greater elasticity in terms of tempo. And so just keep that in mind when you're listening to this. This is a tune that So that being said, if we're thinking about Bunting's editing decisions reflecting larger scholarly trends of the era that involved the transcription and reharmonization of Iyer's tunes, this process of recontextualization involves altering the structure of the music, the matter of transmission, and the aesthetics that govern Irish traditional music. By choosing to ignore these cultural dimensions when arranging Irish music for the piano, Bunting established a scholarly trend that allows for the misrepresentation and alteration of Irish traditional music in association with the piano. The musicologist and musician George Petrie, as we can see there, continued this scholarly trend when he published a similar collection of Irish airs arranged for the piano in 1855 for the Society for the Preservation and Publication of Melodies of Ireland. Now, you can see in this Irish air, which is a little covered, but this Irish air itself is set in the key of G minor. This scholarly trend continues with the wonderful song collector in Chicago and police chief looking rather stern there, Francis O'Neill, who many of you may be familiar with. He published O'Neill's music for piano and violin, and he also published Waifs and Strays of Gaelic Melody, which featured pianistic arrangements by the accomplished Irish fiddler and pianist Selena O'Neill. Now, however, we can notice that although Selena O'Neill was well versed in the tradition, she was herself quite the player in terms of the Irish fiddle and also was accomplished as a pianist playing at Carnegie Hall and whatnot. So there's not much excuse here for this, but she's continued this tradition of sort of ignoring some of the modal harmonies that these melodies apply. In particular, if we look at this, and for some of you who may not read music, that's explained to you later on, but if we look all the way at the top there, we can see that there's a D sharp that she's included on this in the Monahan jig. That sharpening of the D sharp, of course, disrupts the modal nature of the melody, particularly those harmonies underneath, and eventually clashes with the D major that's outlined later on. And you can see the melody itself there. It also establishes a tritone relationship between the D sharp and the A at the very top, which is sort of a hallmark of Western art music. Harmony, not so much the case, particularly this being said in the Aeolian, wouldn't be the case. There's been arguments made that Selena O'Neill did this knowingly, and that Francis O'Neill was putting pressure on her in order to create a publication that would sell more widely. And by putting some of these harmonizations in there that were closer to Western art music aesthetic that they could have sold to a wider audience, particularly since many of the Irish musicians would not have relied upon such a publication, once again, similar to Bunting and Petrie, in order to learn these tunes. So it's an interesting theory, nonetheless. But that being said, she has continued to have that tradition. So thus, we can see from its earliest associations with Irish music, the piano has been positioned as an instrument that is outside of the tradition and is viewed as being rooted in European mainland musical traditions and culture. Due to the expense of the piano, the instrument would have been largely unattainable for Irish working class musicians and would have been viewed as an instrument of privileged Anglo-Irish musicians. In addition, the immobility and frequent maintenance required for a piano would have been incongruous with other instruments associated with Irish music, such as the Irish harp, accordion, tin whistle, fiddle, flute, etc. Portability is a unifying trait of other instruments associated. When this is coupled with the musician's memorization of Irish tunes, the performer can create music in a wide variety of spaces, ranging from a country kitchen all the way to a crossroads platform dance. It is apparent that the physical design of the piano could not allow for the instrument to function in a similar manner. The larger communal demands placed upon an Irish musician necessitated portable instruments, which further extended the tradition. However, beginning in the 1920s, Irish and non-Irish immigrant musicians in North America were challenging the marginalized position of the piano as being outside of traditional music in Ireland. The confluence of readily available pianos, the emergence of the recording industry, the development of cable bands, and the established community of networks between Irish diaspora communities in Ireland resulted in a period of pianistic experimentation and musical fecundity that would inevitably alter the role of the piano in Irish traditional music and the actual tradition itself. In the mid-1920s, Irish immigrant musical experimentations were being documented by the emerging recording industry, primarily located in New York, but there's also cottage industries that were in Boston and Chicago. Record companies were interested in capitalizing upon musics from different immigrant communities with the hopes of record company is hoping to encourage local immigrant musicians to record. Irish music had been recorded on wax cylinders as early as 1899 by the Edison Company, but when you think of the golden era, quotes, of Irish 78 RPM recordings, that's really from the 1920s until the 1930s, particularly the early 1930s, with a decline of interest in Irish recordings by the record companies starting around 1942 and dipping down to 1953. During this golden era period, we see over 40 companies recording Irish traditional music, but that being said, eventually sort of distilled down into three major record labels, one being Columbia, one being Decca, and one being Victor. And so what would happen is these smaller record companies in Boston, Chicago, and New York would go out and find local immigrant musicians, record them, and then they would bring them to these major labels for distribution and occasionally market them. During this period of recording, there's a number of influential Irish immigrant musicians, such as Jane Morrison, Michael Coleman, Paddy Kilcoyne, so we can see this lovely photo in there, John McKenna, William Moley, amongst others who made recordings for piano companies, which were quite influential. Some of these pianists who accompanied these wonderful elder players included Ivan O'Shea, Claire Bearden, Della McMahon, Ed McGann, Paddy Muldoon, Sean Frame, Frank Fallon, Charlotte Bender, and as well as non-Irish pianists such as Joe Linder, Tom Banks, and John Mueller. Recording industry executives at the time felt these recordings would sell better if there was piano accompaniment due to American audiences' familiarity with the piano and other musical contexts. Some of the hired piano accompanists on these recordings were well accustomed to playing Irish traditional music, while others were clearly not. Those of you who go back and listen to those recordings know what I'm talking about. There's some unusual harmonizations and rhythmic accompaniment. So there's this sort of great disparity in terms of quality in the nature of accompaniment. Some of that had to do with the rush speed in which they would force these recordings, and sometimes they're literally plucking pianists out of the street, as one musician discusses. But there's also these sort of early studio musicians who would have been playing klezmer music in the morning, recording Polish music in the afternoon, and maybe recording Irish music in the evening. Some pianists were able to handle this better than others. So that being said, it's interesting to think about that. Many of these recordings, however, were popular among the large number of Irish expatriates living in North America. With newfound jobs, they were able to purchase these recordings with disposable income and help support these cottage industries. Many of these recordings found their way back to Ireland via the 78 RPM recordings and radio broadcasts. Now, these early recordings made primarily by fiddlers, many from whom were from County Sligo, helped to disseminate the Sligo musical style, which featured fast virtuosic tempos, limited amounts of ornamentation, and a particular repertoire of tunes. These recordings provided musicians the ability to analyze the tunes and the Sligo musical style in greater detail due to the technological possibility of playback and slowing the record speed. And some of the, when these records came out, there's accounts from different musicians discussing literally putting their finger on the records, particularly in that season that Michael Coleman could play with very fast virtuosic tempos to be able to hear what they were doing and kind of figure that out. So it was useful in terms of learning. But that being said, these recordings helped to solidify this Sligo musical style as a dominant influence in Irish traditional music, which featured consistent examples of piano accompaniment, which was relatively unknown at the time in Ireland. Many of these recordings featured a virtuosic melody player playing the tune with a steady rhythmic accompaniment and a basic harmonization of the tune by the pianist. This instrumental pairing of melodic instrument with piano accompaniment established a successful format that continues to this day. So at this point, we're going to play a set of reels for you. You can see here, maybe some of you are familiar with these, some of you are not. Man of the House, Deep Drowsy Maggie, Swinging Gate. Medleys in Irish music, if you're not familiar, are popular. We're going to bring up the wonderful fiddler, Melody Cox, who's going to be playing that. Let me give you a little background in terms of the arrangement and why this occurred. Man of the House was also a favorite of fiddler Michael Coleman, so I was listening to a good bit of his work in relationship to this, and where there's a piano doing some basic accompaniment, and then there's also the fiddler playing melody. In addition to this, in sort of connecting this later on in history in terms of thinking about this format of the piano and the fiddler as this wonderful format, there's a great recording by Frankie Gavin, who's not from Sligo, but loved this tune as well, and he paired up with Brian McGrath on the album Fierce Traditional, and so there's a wonderful arrangement of that as well. So I've sort of listened to both and been drawn from that. So how much more do we be playing? That was the reels. The phenomena of the Irish-American Cayley Band spread to Ireland via part the 78 RPM recordings, but also the foundation of the Irish radio broadcasting in 1926 and the opening of commercial dance halls. In Ireland, dancing occurred historically at social gatherings, at a house, a crossroads dance, etc. However, in 1935, we see that the Dance Hall Act was passed, which required that all public dances be licensed by the state. Consequently, the new popular ensemble format of the Cayley Band was able to entertain these dancers in large dance halls. It should be noted that Cayley Bands were particularly popular in rural areas where their services were greatly needed. Urban centers such as Dublin had Cayley Bands, but of course, there was a good deal of competition in terms of entertainment in these areas. As the number of Cayley Bands increased during the 1930s and 1950s, Cayley pianists developed and codified the role of pianist as well as accompaniment techniques. The Cayley pianist was often referred to as a backer, literally backing up the melody players, since the piano provided rhythmic and harmonic accompaniment but did not perform the melodies. Since the tunes consisted of repetitive melodies, musicians such as the pianist and the drummer were viewed as non-core participants within the tradition and were relegated to a secondary status in relation to melody players, which is killing me as I'm saying this. But it's true. So while pianists and drummers were valued for their musical accompaniment, they were assigned a lower status in the hierarchy of Irish traditional music. So during this time period, Cayley pianists such as Kitty Linnane, who we'll see here in her old age, of the Kilfenora Cayley Band, Bridie Lafferty of the Castle Cayley Band, Anna Rafferty of the Balnakil Cayley Band, Josephine Keegan, amongst others, developed these repeating rhythmic devices and harmonies that became the basis for the pianist accompaniment of Irish traditional music. Since they accompanied dance tunes, their accompaniment featured driving, infectious rhythmic quality known as lift, which some of you may be familiar with. Imparting a strong sense of lift to the dancers during performance was essential for Cayley pianists, as opposed to providing very intricate harmonizations of the tunes. The nature and function of the dance tunes dictated the style of pianistic accompaniment. Now, at this point in the lecture, we're going to give you sort of a taste of Cayley band music. The Irish traditional music ensemble is going to come up here now. It was devised to perform in that sort of format of playing singular melody line with piano and drum kit accompaniment. I would like to take this chance to reintroduce you to Josie Davenport, Melanie Cox, Josie Morton, Bjorn Stange, and Alex Kurt on drums. I think you'll enjoy this. This is pretty packed, but if you do really feel the need to get up and move about, now would be the acceptable time. Just before we get started, I would like to make a few points here about why these tunes were chosen, and also just sort of the nature of Cayley pianists. One, the clavel jig, clavel being literally a place in County Sligo, is interesting just because that was a jig that some of these Sligo fiddlers would have enjoyed playing. Second, the Monaghan jig, if you remember, was a piece Celine O'Neill harmonized with some of those odd D sharp, the tritone in there and whatnot. That will not be included. The Cayley format of playing the modal harmonies that the melodies applied instead of furthering the bizarre, in my opinion, harmonies by Celine O'Neill. Second, in terms of, I was talking about differing understandings of Irish music and being well versed in it. Particularly, Bunting or Peachy would have been considered outside the tradition. Some of the pianists that recorded on those 78 RPMs were outside of the tradition, although some of them were well versed in it. The majority of Cayley band pianists would have been well versed in the tradition. They would have known many of the dances, possibly performed them themselves in their off hours. Many of them came from musical families, so they knew a good number of melody players. Also, the community would have helped them. A number of these pianists also started off as melody players, so they would have been much more well versed in the tradition. So that's something to keep in mind for those of you who are familiar with Cayley band music, and particularly looking at the historical development of pianistic techniques. They would have known these tunes in a degree that some of the previous musicologists and musicians would not have known. So keep that in mind. So that being said, we're going to be playing through the clavel jig and the Monaghan jig and Cayley's coming. So the popularity of ceilidh bands in both Ireland and North America began to wane in popularity in the 1950s. While the ceilidh band format was losing popular favor, academics and folk music enthusiasts in North America and the United Kingdom encouraged a renewed interest in Irish traditional music, particularly in the early 1960s, in partial response to the relatively unsophisticated ceilidh band arrangements in certain musicians' eyes. Irish traditional musicians looked to smaller formats, more intricate arrangements. Also, at this time period, there's a number of factors that they use in closing the dance halls and that sort of tradition, losing popular favor. Many of these sort of Irish immigrant communities, particularly in North America, began to assimilate more and flew out into the suburbs, and so these communities started to change quite a bit around the 1960s. So there's a number of factors to why ceilidh band music wasn't as popular. But that being said, as a professor of music at the University College Cork, Sean O'Riordan sought to modernize Irish traditional music ensemble format. As a classically trained pianist, harpsichordist, and composer, he sought to apply his understanding of harmony and sophisticated arrangements to Irish traditional music. O'Riordan founded and directed the ensemble, which many of you may know, called the Eric Wallen, and you can see O'Riordan hiding over here in the corner on harpsichord. And so many of the tunes that he found came from the Bunting and Petrie collections, as well as living Irish musicians. And so he was interested in creating this modern ensemble formation and modern arrangements in order to present a new musical creation that drew upon native Irish musical culture and modernist musical concepts. O'Riordan primarily performed on harpsichord in this ensemble. Informed by his classical music training, O'Riordan sought to develop the role of the keyboardist in Irish traditional music by performing the melody with his right hand while simultaneously providing harmonic and rhythmic accompaniment with the left hand. O'Riordan introduced contrapuntal accompaniment to Irish melodies and largely avoided the characteristic rhythmic and harmonic devices of ceilidh piano accompaniment. This departure from ceilidh piano accompaniment resulted in the liberation of the role of the keyboardist. O'Riordan's ability to perform Irish melodies on the piano and the harpsichord laid the groundwork for the development of a new style of piano performance in Irish traditional music. And so we're going to take a look here. And this is a tune that was taken from the Bunting collection once again in 1840. And this is entitled O'Neill's Cavalcade or O'Neill's March. And so O'Riordan studied this, and obviously there were some contrapuntal arrangements that Bunting and Petrie would have added there. But really, it's O'Riordan doing the sort of contrapuntal accompaniment techniques in an ensemble format. It's relatively new. So he studied this and then sort of made some changes to this. Interesting enough, I learned this from one of the O'Riordan students as a solo piano piece while we'll be discussing after this performance. But what I'd like you to listen to is the ensemble arrangement and also sort of the contrapuntal piano work that goes on there. In terms of the arrangement itself, I lifted this from the recording of O'Riordan, which you guys thank you, at the Gaiety Theater in the early 1960s. This was quite new to the Irish audience to hear this sort of modern ensemble. And so what he's done is taken this and put it himself on harpsichord but layered it with his ensemble. And so I've tried to do that with this group. Of course, we don't have the pipes, which was in his arrangement, but we need to. So please sit back and enjoy, and we're going to be playing O'Neill's Cavalcade or O'Neill's March.
Thank you.
Alois Fleischmann at the University College Cork, he also then sought to further develop his role of piano in Irish traditional music. During an interview I conducted in 2007, Osulban discussed the important impact of Oireachtas had on his musical development. It was in Oireachtas' class at UCC, or University College Cork, that Osulban first heard him perform a traditional tune on the piano, and then later on the harpsichord. It was during these occasions that Osulban realized that he could perform what he knew about Irish traditional music and translate it to the piano. While at University College Cork, Osulban made a radio broadcast while he discussed and demonstrated how one could perform Irish traditional music on the piano. Osulban imitated certain ornamentations on the piano and played different tunes with and without accompaniment. He was proving to his listening audience and himself that it was possible to play Irish traditional music on the piano. Osulban describes his right hand, which is usually playing the melody right tune, as a driving rhythmical force that pushes the momentum of the tune forward. During performances, Osulban has mentioned that the right hand is essential since it carries the essence of the tune, the melody, the essence of the tradition. Osulban stated, quote, "The right hand makes the piano sound Irish. Practice with your left hand in your pocket, otherwise it will distract you," which I think is an interesting statement on the last part of the pianist. But the right hand relentlessly pursues the rhythm. That's part of the melody. Osulban also accents rhythmic key points with his right hand as well. By combining the driving rhythm and melody of the right hand and occasionally a syncopated accompanying accents on the left hand, Osulban is able to create a strong feeling of lift and a clear sense of movement. Harmonically speaking, Osulban has developed a unique harmonic language that draws upon Irish traditional music, Western classical music, or art music, and jazz. Therefore, he's able to sort of switch between these different styles of harmonic accompaniment. I did a transcription from a recording of Old John's jig on the album Poelia, in which we can see some of his harmonic work here in particular. You can see in the left hand that this tune is in A minor, but you can see it outlines just the E and the A, that fourth, and he avoids playing the third for the majority of the piece, giving it almost a drone-like quality to this piece. You can also see he combines this cluster here, the E, A, and B, which give it this sort of sustained feeling throughout. So he's able to sort of accent certain parts of the jig without disrupting it too much. He also sort of occasionally uses chordal harmony, which is stacked chords and fourths, but this is not such a case really. In addition to this, he also employs something known as the crayon in some of his piano music. It's a type of ornamentation which can be originally attributed to the Ilian pipes. It's when you have a note and you repeat it in staccato fashion. He was able to sort of translate this to the piano, and he's able to do this by hitting the note with his third finger, second finger, and thumb. So I'm gonna knock this thing over here a little bit. So his ability to do that is quite unique, particularly as a melody performer. And so this next musical example, well, this is what we're going to be performing, is music for a found harmonium. I've outlined sort of where you can find the crayon during the performance in that beginning melody there and what that sounds like. But just listen to that repeated note and it should be pretty clear. We're going to be performing this in an ensemble format. What I'm going to do is be playing the melody of the piano Osulban style, and we're going to be having the groups come in staggered. So hopefully you'll enjoy that. I'll switch to this. Okay. So we're going to do music for a found harmonium. Thank you. One, before you head out, let me just, this is Josie Davenport. Please give her a round of applause. Ellen House. Josie Morton. Warren Stange. And of course, Alex Stewart. We have these guys. That being said, getting back to discussing the Sullivan. So, if we do sort of an in-depth analysis of Sullivan's recordings, we're able to uncover the significant innovative contributions he's made towards redefining the role of pianists in artificial music. His pianistic style has impacted younger pianists. One that comes to mind is a man named Patrick O'Reilly. You can see him here. And he's an interesting case because he's able to play in that Sullivan style, playing the melody with the right hand and doing contrapuntal and chordal accompaniment. But he's also quite at home in terms of vamping. He's the musical director of the escaping band. So he's an interesting example. Another one in terms of the modern ensemble format is a man named Lee Bradley. We can see him playing on an electronic keyboard, but he plays piano quite a bit. And he once again is at home in terms of playing the melody with the other melody players and also providing harmonic and rhythmic accompaniment. So this is sort of duality to the piano's role. So although the piano is still frequently cited as a non-traditional instrument, it has maintained an evolving role in Irish traditional music for nearly a century. Evidence of its gradual acceptance within the exclusive boundaries of Irish traditional music can be found not only in pianistic performing practices, but in the governing criteria of Fláth Chomh Éireann, which is the International Irish Traditional Music Competition. That's organized by the non-profit Irish cultural organization, Cultus. And so this is interesting. I was able to attend one of the competitions, musical competitions, last year in New Jersey, in the Mid-Atlantic, and they have the Mid-Atlantic and the Midwestern, the best of the best, they would argue for a competition. And so I lifted this from their criteria, and we go all the way to this side, and we see solo competitions for melody. You can see all the wonderful instruments they have, and the piano, which I think is quite interesting. It's a rather conservative organization. And if you look all the way at the bottom here, and scroll across, you can see you can also piano as an accompanist. I think that's interesting in terms of thinking about the boundaries of, in terms of degrees of acceptance. And of course, also lifted from their criteria here is how you can compete as a pianist with a cave band. And so you're also able to do that. So you're able to do it as a soloist with one melody player as an accompanist, and then you're also able to do it in the format of the cave band. So in closing, I suggest that due to the piano's instrumental limitations and unusual history, it was primarily through its use in Irish diasporic musical activities that it was able to establish an uneasy foothold in Irish traditional music. Although it has not been fully accepted into the folds of Irish traditional music as other instruments have, it has maintained a consistent role as both a lead melodic and accompanying, as accompanying capacity, as it slowly gains wider acceptance into the tradition. I'm going to leave you with this and then a few thoughts before we have some questions. This is just sort of an outline from the tune collectors, showing eras of influence here, 78 RPMs, the longer format recordings, modern ensembles, the academic influence, and the cave influence. These are different areas in which the piano has developed, and there's just listings of the different pianists there. But a couple of things. One, in terms of questions, you may be wondering, well, to what degree does the piano have to be fully accepted? What does that actually mean for the piano to be fully accepted into the tradition? And I think we will see that be fully accepted when the piano is accepted in terms of playing the melody, say, at a session. And that's not something that's a party piece, but in which that's the same as a normal melodic instrument, which it's currently not. There's certain musical contexts where that would be appropriate, but there's still some that are not. And whether that not that will happen, we'll see. Although I think it is interesting to see that sort of younger pianists feel more comfortable in this role of the lead melodic performer, but also in terms of the accompaniment. And in terms of thinking about the future of the piano in our tradition music, moving forward, I don't necessarily think it's the piano itself, in terms of the physicality of the instrument, but I think it's the sound of the instrument. If you look, it's the reproduction of the sound of the piano, which I think is where this is headed. Particularly if you look at the number of keyboardists, even if you go back to that one clean breath, he's playing a keyboard. If you look at sessions where piano is accepted, and that's still a questionable at certain times, you see pianists bring in a certain keyboard that's battery powered, and there's speakers there. When I went to the Mid-Atlantic FLA, that was all electronic keyboards. And if you look at the governing criteria for flat golden heron, the only electronic instrument allowed is the keyboard, is the electronic keyboard, which is interesting. So it would be in that sort of sense of developing that. And if you look at dance halls, many of you have gone to pubs or whatnot and ever seen a piano, they're typically out of tune and pretty to get out there with some shotgun. So I think that's really where it's headed, is the sort of reproduction of the sound of the piano. So if you have questions, please. Before we dig in, though, I would like to say one more time, thank you to you guys. Without your help and lovely playing, I wouldn't have been able to do this. So thank you very much to the UFI Traditional Music Ensemble. Thank you to Dr. Larry Crook for your guidance and help, and also to Dr. Tremara, who's in absentia, but is really helping out as well. So, and of course, the Fantasy is really Trent. I don't know where he is, but he's really won a lot of awards and accolades. So if you have questions, please shoot. I know there's some experts or whatnot. So. Concerns?
I have a question.
Fears?
Yes. Cape Breton music, from what I've heard, the piano, or like you say, electronic keyboards seem integral to that music.
Yeah.
Has it had a similar evolution as with Irish, or did they always just accept it?
Yeah,
it seems more like an accompaniment.
I think some of that, why the piano has had harder time, I guess, being accepted. I think if you look back in terms of the way our tradition music was linked with nationalism, sort of those governing bodies were quite strict on what could be accepted. I think there's also this issue of sort of cultural ownership to a degree between Ireland and Irish America. I mean, if you look at the development of the piano, it happens, the majority of it's happening in North America in that way. It's a slow process to have it go back to Ireland. In terms of Cape Breton, they seem much more willing to allow that to happen. And it seems much more sort of a looser formation. I mean, I also know in Cape Breton, they also would perform on pump organs and other, like they'd find, organs that were cheap and sold. And so that was accepted as well. And it didn't raise an eye. So I think if you look at that, I think there's just a greater degree of acceptance possible in terms of that, because it has become But that being said, I think the piano has, in certain areas of Irish traditional music, really is integral. I mean, like dance competitions, you see the piano there a good bit, or the ceilidh bands and that stuff. And I mean, most ceilidh bands you wouldn't think of would have a piano, it exists, but I mean, so that's. So I think really, on a broader scale, it's really a North American phenomenon, because you don't see that in much. Since Cape Breton is sort of Scottish music, you don't see that in Scotland as well. Now the music is that sort of flow back. So I think that's what it comes down to. I don't know if that helps answer your question. I mean, it's also because it made me think about the development of when those immigrants were coming over and establishing it. They also have sort of those factories mass producing pianos, and particularly in the Northeast. So they, there's that ability to have access to those. And there was a sort of discussion in terms of Ireland when these RPMs are coming back and they were trying to build ceilidh bands in Ireland. There was not even enough pianos to have them, and they didn't have enough people to play them. So one of the reasons you see a lot of female ceilidh band pianos in Ireland is because they sort of have that training in combat school. So it's really, it's unusual. It's quite a stark difference in terms of access to the pianos, sort of the home country versus North America. Yes? But in terms of providing accompaniment, not as much, it's more just for the body. In terms of, you would have some of that, in terms of the accompaniment, there's obviously the buttons you're able to do that, but from the way in which that's done, it's not in the same way as the piano. I think it's closer sometimes the way the pipes are. I've read descriptions of that. Of some, there's some accompaniment, it's almost imitated with the pipes might hit and just accompaniment, as opposed to that sort of consistent, you know,
just kind of. I just see that, and there's so many, the accordion when it's spread, mm-hmm. in the 19th century, really, mm-hmm. there's so many examples around the world. Now this gets tagged as a folk instrument.
Right.
So
right.
I just feel like it would be a natural kind of
yeah.
thing in this context, but I don't ever remember seeing, you know, this.
Yeah.
Well,
I know there's also like certain, like the box in terms of the accordion is accepted as a large. I know the piano accordion is outside. So there's really a weird, you know, what can be accepted and what not, and what's not. But you don't see that as much. It's sort of this occasion when you see accordions applied. And then the second one was
by ear.
Yeah, I mean, that's a huge part of the tradition. I mean, part of the discussion of Bunting and Petrie, why are they changing it? It wasn't for Irish musicians who primarily went by ear. Where you see the really by ear portion is when you get up to, say, those cable band pianists, a lot of the 78 RPM, all those guys were playing Bunting. That being said, though, there is a number of cable pianists and 78 RPM pianists with a classical background. So they would be musically literate, but they would be playing, many of them would be playing the ear, particularly the cable band. So there's still that desire to stay within that tradition. And that's another issue with the piano, is the idea that you're rotating the music and sort of going against the tradition, and you know, working on is that acceptable. But in terms of cable band recording, that's maintained. And that's maintained to this day. This ensemble is strict in the way it would be with competing ones. It's just a bit of other questions, concerns? You can always email me questions if you have burning questions. I did get a wonderful cheese and fruit platter. I have some fruit juice. I will have health issues if I eat all that stuff, so I want you to at least join me and informally ask me strange questions or whatnot. But thank you for all coming out. I know it's a beautiful day. Thank God we have AC in here.